konuklarımız, afet yönetiminde ileri teknolojilerin kullanımı AFTEK 2013 GÜS çalıştayının ikinci gününe hoş geldiniz. Davetli konuşmacımız Profesör Doktor Alexander Kleiner'i tanıtmak üzere Hasari Çelebi'yi sahneye davet ediyorum.
Merhabalar. Davetli konuşmacımız İngilizce konuştuğu için İngilizce bir biyografisini okuyacağım. It's my honor to introduce Professor Alexander Kleiner. Here is short bio. Alexander Kleiner is a faculty member in the AIICS Research Division and leads the group on collaborative research, collaborative robotics in Linköping University in Sweden. He received his PhD from the University of Freiburg in Germany in February 2008 and worked as an invited guest researcher at the Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh in US in 2010, at the La Sapienza University in Rome, Italy in 2011. Since 2006, he's member of the executive committee of RoboCup Rescue Simulation League. His research areas are autonomous robot exploration, simultaneous localization and mapping, which is known as SLAM, and mixed initiative teams of humans and multi-robot systems. The main concern of his work is on developing reliable multi-robot, multi-agent teams coordinating and acting in real time and to contribute in the development of performance metrics for benchmarking their real-world applicability. He successfully participated in several international robot competitions where his teams won several times the first prize. So please welcome to Professor Kleiner.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's a honor for me to be being invited here for this conference. Thank you very much. So today I will I have a lot of videos on my slides, so it will not be too tactical, I want to give you an idea about what can be done with robots in the future. So it's advanced technology, it's something which you don't have nowadays on robots, it's something which we develop in research and which we also have tested together with responders. So I will talk about single autonomous systems. These are robots which are acting on their own. Operator assistive mapping, this is a software or support for operators in the field. These are incident commanders which are controlling robots, they get support. And at the last point, collaborative robotics. So first of all, I will show some examples of systems we developed in the beginning. At the beginning, we were also starting with competitions, RoboCup Rescue. And in such a competition, you have a setup where the robots have to overcome certain difficulties. Of course, this is not like in a real situation after disaster, but it's a stepwise increase towards that. And a first version we were developing is this platform, which we call CIRC. Is not a platform which is suitable for urban search and rescue, but it is actually a fast platform for reconnaissance. So you can send it into an environment, and it has an infrared camera, a 3D laser rangefinder, and it can actually go very fast. And we developed several versions. So the first version was actually based on the letterbox. At that time, we didn't have so much money to build robots, so we started with something very simple. Our goal at the beginning was anyway to build very cheap robots and not so expensive robots. And this is just a platform you can use to go into some structures and get some video feeds. Further development of the structure is like this. which was capable to overcome a bit more complicated terrain. So you can see the newspapers. That's something what you have after a disaster. You have a lot of newspapers everywhere if a building collapses. So robots have to be able to overcome newspapers. But of course, this is still a very simple environment, and it's not something you have. It's not as challenging as in a real world. But this is the next step we were actually going. And we further developed this platform to go faster. And so these systems here, what you see, they are not controlled by a human. They are going autonomously at this point. So they have sensors. They perceive the world by the sensors in the same way as human has eyes. And then they make decisions what kind of commands to execute. That's what we call autonomous systems. And this is what I show here. And it's something you cannot buy nowadays, because the robot systems are all controlled by humans nowadays, especially in urban search and rescue. There is no autonomous system. Yeah, a further development was then a platform we called Lurker. This is a, this platform was a bit more capable to go over terrain. You see in the background this kind of this kind of structure in the background here is this testing environment which you have built by NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, for testing your robots. And the platform we were developing was first also teleoperated. So we had an operator with a joystick which controlled this robot for climbing stairs, as you can see. At that time, it was already difficult for an operator to do this. You must imagine the operator does not see the robot. The operator only sees the image from the camera, because the operator has to be in a safety zone. And then the task is to climb up, for example, a stair with the robot or anything else, climbing any kind of other structure. And this is difficult. So that's why we continue to develop more intelligence or more smart kind of artifacts into the system. And this system now is capable of climbing the stairs autonomously. So you just put the robot in front of the stairs, and it finds the stair and it climbs it up. So you can take off your hands of the joystick. This is already a big help for an operator. And what we had to do is to put in some sensors into this platform, and then to develop the right algorithms for making this possible. But this platform is still at some point stupid, because it doesn't know about it is going over a stair. It just can feel the stair, but it doesn't know the context. And that's why we were continuing a development with a smarter platform like this one, which was then able to generate a map of the environment by the techniques of SLAM, and to select targets, target locations, and to explore the environment. This is also a picture from the final competition of RoboCup 2006. And in this competition, the robot has to find simulated victims. So you have basically heat sources in the environment, and the robot has to find these heat sources by infrared camera and to make a map and to show to the operator where these sources are. This is very difficult. It does look simple, but this is the ongoing development. And here the robot found one victim, a simulated victim. And in order to do that, the system has to understand the environment. It has to understand how traversable are certain parts of the environment. So the system now on the right-hand side is capable of generating a little map, as you can see in the upper right corner. And this map is a representation of the environment. And the system can detect the stairs. It can detect the pallet, for example, in front. And then it can plan and decide what to do next. So this is, you can see, an increasing, stepwise increasing kind of intelligence of such systems. What you have nowadays in robots that you can buy, like from iRobot company, is just only the first level which is a teleoperated robot. So this is what we talk about autonomous systems that can make decisions autonomously. Of course, you don't want a fully autonomous system at the end. You don't want to have a Terminator like in the movies, but you want a system which is smarter than what you have nowadays, so that the operator can control the system more easily. And the last system we were building on this line was the TechX challenge. This was a challenge by the DSTA, is a Singapore Defense Ministry. And in this chat here we had a more serious robot, which was also a bit more expensive than the one before. And on this robot we had a 6 degrees of freedom manipulator and so-called flippers, which are these legs. And these flippers can be rotated in order to overcome complicated terrain, as you can see on the next slide, next video. And there was a challenge, and these are videos from the qualification which we went through, and you see the judges behind the robot. They are ensuring by an emergency button that this robot is not harming anybody, but it was no problem. And this was the test for the navigation task, and then there was also a test for the stair climbing. So the robot has to detect these stairs, to find the stairs, and then to climb the stairs. And the last one was a bit more challenging. In the last task, the robot had to operate an elevator. So you put the robot into an elevator, and it has to find the buttons, and also it has to go inside autonomously. So the overall picture of this challenge was that you have a building, and you send a robot in that building, and you want the robot to find targets in this building. It's a little bit a military application also, that it depends what kind of targets you're searching for at the end, right? So in rescue, you search for victims, and in this application, you would search for terrorists. But the robot has to go in autonomously and to explore the whole building. And this is still nowadays a very difficult task which you cannot solve. So this competition, nobody won it, actually, because it's too difficult. But our robot was able to at least operate an elevator autonomously, which was already some achievement. Yeah, and from all this research, we had at the end the idea to come up with a product. The first product we were doing is operator-assistive mapping. And we had a company, a Telerob company, working with us together. And you see this platform. This is the Telemax robot. The shape is in that way that you can also enter airplanes. So you can actually go into a plane and you can open the lockers with this platform, with the manipulator. It's mainly built for bomb disposal, but it can also be used for urban search and rescue because it is it can go over very difficult terrain, as you can see from the structure. And our work was to build a mapping system for this platform, which helps the operator to find the way in the building or in the structure, and also to find the way out again. Yeah? So you can imagine, if you have a complicated structure, it's difficult for an operator, from the camera images, to understand the structure of the environment. And on the right-hand side, you see, I show it on this side, you see the map, which is emerging automatically while the operator is driving the robot into the structure. And this was the goal of this work. And the reason why you need that is also that you want somehow completeness of search. If you search a building for victims, you want to be sure that no victim is there after you're done. But if you have a complicated structure, as you can see here, this is a map of a simulated environment which was built up by NIST. This is like a maze they built up, and the operators have to go inside with the robot. And here the operator was missing some part. He was actually missing one door, and then he missed the whole part of the structure. And this is something you want to avoid. And if you have a mapping system, you have the entire map, and you know that you have seen everything. This is why this is important, especially if you search for victims. Yeah, and so the operator which navigates the robot has a lot of tasks to do at the same time. First of all, he has to navigate the robots in a safe way without tipping over or without crashing into some structures. Then the operator has to detect things from the video stream. So this is always task-related. If you are a bomb disposal operator, then you want to see the suitcases or something which could contain possibly a bomb. If you are a rescue personnel, you want to see hazmats or you want to see victims. And you have to detect this from the video streams while you try to navigate into the structure. And the third thing is the navigation, which is the mapping And the understanding of the structure of the building, you sent the robot in. And this is exactly what our system here is actually solving for the operator. So there are only two things left then, what the operator has to do. And this is important because operators are usually under high pressure. If they go, if they have a rescue mission, there's high pressure, psychologically wise. And so they cannot do all of these things at the same time. That's why nowadays you have not one operator, you have three operators in such a mission, which control one robot. So three person, one robot. This is the ratio you have nowadays. And if you can reduce this load by some assistive technology, then the operator has a much more safe way of operation. But if you do such a technology, then it has to work under real conditions. So this is a FEMA personnel operating a robot in this test structure, in this maze, you just have seen the map from. And you see the way of driving is very rude. So this shows that if responders navigate a robot, they do it in a very harsh way. It's not like computer scientists, they would do it very slowly. And in that way, the software has to actually cope with such a kind of driving style. And the state of the art nowadays is that you have actually several people controlling one robot, and you have a very high training effort for that. So to do this kind of thing, you have seen these people have to be trained, and because it's not so easy, and this costs a lot of money and a lot of time, and you need, as I said, three persons for a single robot, which is also something you want to change in the future. So you want to have like one person for three robots. This was also just recently during the Fukushima Daiichi incident. There were actually a mission flown with a T-Hawk from Honeywell, and they had three people, which were one person for the mapping, one person for the navigation, and one person was the incident commander. So the incident commander is standing behind them and watching their work, and one guy is controlling the robot and the other guy is making a map of the environment. This is still 2011 the case, and they couldn't actually go into the structure. Yeah. And this looks like this. These are two FEMA personnel doing the test in Disaster City. And this white sheet, what you see, is a standardized FEMA sheet for doing maps. Yeah? And so you see one person is driving and the other person is discussing where they actually are. Yeah. Okay. And due to this, we were developing a mapping system for this, which we test also in Disaster City. And this mapping system was integrated on this Telemax robot, as you can see here. It's this little box on the back. You just put it on the robot. And then you see on the operator console the map emerging while the robot is driven through the environment. And this looks like this. And it's also here a laser scanner used for that. I don't talk too much about the algorithms at this point, but you get an idea what this system is doing. You can see here the robot as a red rectangle. And you see the path the robot has taken. And in that way, the operator gets an idea where the robot is located in the structure. And it's also easy to find the way back. It's like a GPS car navigation system, after all, you can have here. And the operator can also annotate parts of the map if there was some detection of something. For example, here's a part of an airplane in the test facility of this company, or there comes a car, and these things can be annotated in order to get an idea of the structure. So this is then not an autonomous system anymore, but it's some kind of robotics technology supporting an existing system. Okay. And this is a responder using it, finally.
So I can see that there's more stuff over here. Now I'm watching this map. See how the map's filling in there?
Oh, yeah, okay.
So I know that I can't, if I go right, I'm just going to go back to where I've already been because it's already painted that picture. Since I'm trying to drive it out of here.
So that's maybe a bit hard to understand, but this was an FBI responder, and this was a person. He was using robots many years already in real incidents in Los Angeles for chasing criminals, I guess. And he was many times with a robot in a structure, and he understood the need for such a system that he can understand where he's located, and he was immediately using it. Other people, of course, have a bit longer time until they can understand how to use the technology. But I think it's something very important to have a mapping system on a robot in the next generation, and should focus also research work on that. Yeah, so then I would come to the second part, which is about collaborative systems. And this is a bit a different thing. The idea here is that, of course, in nature you see many systems which are very efficient by collaboration, like ants, for example. Ants, they can build bridges into the air, like on this picture, which can be used by other ants to overcome gaps in nature. Or you can have ants which are actually harvesting leaves and bring these leaves to caves and grow fungi. These are things which are existing in nature, and this is amazing if you see that, how nature gets efficient by collaboration. And so collaboration about robots, of course, is also something you want to have in the future. If you think about the search for victims, this is all about collaboration, and if you have robots, they can easily communicate by wireless transmission, maybe more efficient than humans can do. And here the structure of, you have many, many different algorithms or solutions for this topic, but the part where I'm working in is on the left side, which is collaboration. In that way, in this kind of problem, all the units have a common goal. They can also have conflicting goals or individual goals, like on the right-hand side, but the algorithms we are developing is for systems having common goals. And then it comes to planning, task assignment, and search algorithms. And this is where I will now give a little insight to them. So one project we are doing is called Sherpa. This is a EU project, a very big EU project with 10 partners and more than 10 million euro. Funding, and the idea here is to develop solutions for the Alps, for rescue in the Alps. So this is a little bit different to rescue after urban search and rescue, but some technologies are sometimes overlapping at some point. So the idea here is to have a team of heterogeneous robots. Heterogeneous means they are different. They can be flying, they can be ground robots, they can be helicopters, and to have them cooperatively supporting the rescue personnel in the Alps. And there are basically two scenarios, which is a summer and a winter scenario. And I will talk more about the summer scenario. The winter scenario is mainly if you have an avalanche, as you have seen in the video just before, for example, and then the task to quickly find the buried people under the snow. This is something which is very time critical. It's about a range of 10 minutes. And the hope is also to have here UAVs to support this search. But I will talk about the summer scenario. And the summer scenario is also very interesting. So here the problem is that you have hikers which are just lost in the Alps. Yeah? Or you have a call that people are just lost in the mountains. And I have here only the statistical data from Italy because these are our partners in the project. But there might be similar data for Turkey or other countries. And in Italy, there are about 30 to 40 missions, operations per week. This is quite a lot. Operations overall in 2010 were 5,813. And rescued people in Italy, just in Italy only, 6,000. Now think about Italy has only a small part of the Alps. It's not a mountain country. You can imagine. I guess in Turkey there are similar numbers or much higher numbers than that. And if you see here the statistics, this is the number of people which are actually lost in the mountains. So that means they are gone. Yeah? They are not rescued. Nobody has seen them again. This is, I also think, very strange that there are so many people lost in the mountains. It's a big number then, if you think about it, yeah, for such a small area, comparably. So this is the reason why there has to be some robotics technology in place for supporting the search. And nowadays, the typical search mission is like this. The emergency units, they receive a call, and then the team is approaching the area where the victim has been seen the last time. So they typically go by car to this place. And then the next important step is to determine the direction where the victim might have gone to. And they can use dogs for that. This is actually the only point where they use dogs for this kind of search mission. They don't use the dogs for anything else because they are not useful at this point. But they use the dogs to get a direction by smelling where the person might have gone to. Or they might ask people whether they have seen where the people walked, in which valley did they go. And this, of course, narrows down the search area a lot, so it's a lot helpful. And then they start to cluster the whole search area and to assign little teams to these clusters. And then they start searching. And what they can do is about 4 hours search and covering an altitude gap of 800 meters and an area of 3 kilometers. This is also a comparably small patch if you have a large area. And they don't have any specific sensing, so they just can hear the victim or see them. And this is also tricky if you're in the Alps, because you cannot see everything there. This is very suboptimal. So the question is how to deploy robots for this task. And our approach is first to generate an elevation map of the entire environment. And for this, we use helicopters. This is a platform which we have in Linköping. It's called the Airmax Yamaha platform. It's a helicopter of the size of a motorcycle. And we mount, it has a high payload, so it can carry about 20 kilograms, 30 kilograms. And we mount a laser scanner on this platform and also some other sensors. And with these sensors, we can generate a map of the search area, basically. And then we apply algorithms for generating this map. So these algorithms are basically taking the sensing the data which has been sent and combine them into an elevation map. So elevation map is what you see here on the right hand side. It's a map which simply tells you the altitudes of each point. And in that way, you have an idea about the terrain. This is something you can get nowadays with all sorts of UAVs. It's quite common technology. Also, already in urban search and rescue, I think there are quadcopters used occasionally. Yeah, and if you have this map, you need a strategy how to search for the victims. One thing you can do is you assume that they are not moving. Then the search is much easier. So this is now here a testing environment we were building in our university for searching for stationary targets. If targets are stationary, it's easier, obviously, because you can systematically search the whole area. And in this testing area, you have a terrain, like you can see here, and you have victims hidden in such boxes. And what you want the robot is to search every of these holes with a sensor, which is mounted on top of the manipulator. And so you need just a plan how to execute the search with the robot. I mean, the same thing you can, of course, do large scale if it's a larger area. And the problem is to find a sequence observation points to cover the entire area. Now, this is the same problem we have also with human. But you want to find the minimal, by the algorithm, you want to find the minimal sequence in order to save time without overlapping. And in our algorithms that we develop, we consider the real sensor model of the sensors. So exactly, we consider what they can see, the visibility, detection, and also the motion model. So there might be different capabilities of robots overcoming terrain, and this is also something you have to account for when computing a search schedule. And what you get at the end is something like this. You have this is a testing environment. Then you generate the map from this environment. This is now a 3D map you see here. And then you generate the schedule where to look at step by step. So the red area is actually which has been seen by a sensor. And then you are done after some while. It's rather simple, but it's complicated if you have a 3D environment, so you need some smart algorithms at this point. But the question is, what can you do if your targets are moving? And this is actually what hikers are doing. It's also the scenario in a military scenario. You might have more targets that are moving than are stationary. So then it's called pursuit evasion, which is the goal to find an intruder in a mission, in a base. This is the scenario on the military side. But if you have a large area and we have lost hikers, we have the same problem. And in this algorithm, we are actually considering elevation maps and the visibility from certain locations, as you can see on the right-hand side. So you can see a person has another visibility, another area it can see than the airplane, for example. And you have to consider this in your computation in order to know what they have to look at. And And we assume in the worst case here so that the targets are omniscient. Omniscient means they know everything, what we are doing. And also we assume that they can move at arbitrary speeds. So they can be fast as they want. And our algorithm will still find them because it's called guaranteed search. And this is very challenging because before people have not considered that. They have only considered very simple problems. So this shows the visibility or the detection set a person can see from a location on the elevation map. So you see the yellow dot, and this is the observer, and the red cells are basically the area the person can see from the location. So you can see it's not that simple because of occlusions. Yeah, there's many occlusions, and you have to consider that when you compute your search schedule, where to put your searches. Like in the Alps, it makes a big difference at which altitude you are and so forth. And then if you have this kind of computation, we have to compute the schedule. Yeah? And this is to show you in a simple way how what the problem here is. So we have an area which is contaminated. This is the gray area where the target is. We have obstacles. And we can place searches in this area. And the blue set, or the blue area, is what the searcher can see due to its sensor. Yeah? And we can place another searcher, and then we have more covered. But since we have robots, we can also move them. And if you move the robots, and then something can happen like this, that we have a so-called cleared area. So this is an area which nobody sees at that time, but also no target can go there because it's protected by the view of the other observer, which is here. So this area is protected by the boundary and by the other observer. So you don't have to put the searcher at this place. And so the problem now is to find a schedule, the smart schedule, which needs the least amount of searches and the least amount of time. And in the real environment, we do this. We first generate the elevation map, then we classify the terrain according to traversability. There are certain areas you cannot reach. For example, if it's a very steep mountain, you don't need to search there because nobody can go up. Then we apply some kind of hierarchical sampling to cover the whole area and generate a graph. And this graph actually denotes our observation points and is the basis for computing our schedule. And the scheduled computation finds now a way how to place searches on the nodes of this graph stepwise. And finally, we need a strategy how to assign the searches to these nodes. So the first thing gives us just a strategy, and then the target assignment is the second step. These are all very complicated problems in computer science, but you can find heuristic solutions which can do this in a very smart way. Yeah, and this is how it looks like. You have the terrain model, elevation map, and the system computes basically a search graph how to search quickly for moving targets. And just to give you an understanding what these edges mean, if we, these edges actually present visual proximity, but also recontamination potential. So you can imagine this example. Here we have a searcher position, and we have a natural boundary, which goes here around. And the red area is what the searcher can see. So if he plays another searcher, the other searcher can partially cover the boundary of the first searcher. If he plays a third searcher, he can also partially cover it. So what that means is that other searchers can actually protect the area of the first searcher. And that means we can remove the first searcher if the area is protected. And this is why we have this the notion of the edges, which basically gives us this understanding. And if we have now a schedule, we can remove a searcher if the boundary is protected in order to ensure that there's no recontamination. And we can also have an overlap with multiple searchers seeing the same boundary, but this is another issue. And the strategy basically is then about, and that's what our algorithms are doing, it computes how to stepwise go through this graph, how to place the searchers on the nodes, and it has to be in a way that there's no recontamination. So we cannot remove this guy here now, because if we would remove the guy, somebody could go from here to that place, and then we would have recontamination. This is the whole concept of this kind of algorithms, and they help to organize a search for a moving target. Yeah. And we have tested this in the real world with a bunch of students, and this was in nearby Carnegie Mellon University. They have a testing environment for robots, but we used it for students. And the students, they all got an iPad, as this guy has in his hands. And the iPad was giving them their position on the map and also the areas they have to observe in the next step. And then we also had target students, also evaders. And, okay, actually this one was the evader. And the evaders, they also had iPads, and they could see the location of all the searchers. So all they had to do is just to escape from them to not be detected. And given the map, it's a pretty easy task because they can see where the searchers are coming. But they have to, they can hide somewhere and try whatever they want. And we had a bit problem with this environment because it was raining and it was also changing the mountain, also the little hills. So it was a bit different. But after all, it worked very nicely, even given the fact that the area was changed a lot. And this shows now the GPS tracks, traces. I will repeat that. So the green line is basically the searchers, and the blue and the pink is the evaders. And we can see this, stepwise. So the first step, they were going out, and the red triangle denotes a detection. And at the beginning, the evaders, they weren't tuned, didn't understand how to work, so they were detected. So this one is not counting, actually. But then they were proceeding, the searchers. And you see that the evaders, they're trying to escape from them. And in a very efficient way, but at the end, they always have been detected because the schedule guarantees that there is no way to not be found. So this is, of course, now very, very much a search and pursuit scenario, but the same thing can happen if you search for people which are lost in the Alps. They can do exactly the same thing just by coincidence. Yeah? So they can try to perfectly avoid you without knowing, and this is why you need algorithms which are strong, which can do that at this point. And we are working also now on an extension which is more suitable for UAVs, so that you have UAVs which can quickly sweep through the environment for the search. This is actually very similar, as you can imagine, people searching with sticks for people. They're building a row, and then they go with the sticks through the environment. The same thing you can do with UAVs, which are just aligned in this way, as you can see here. And then you need algorithms to pursue through the environment in a systematic manner, as you can see here. So this is also an elevation map as an input. And then you have a schedule which lets the searches just go through until the whole area is cleared. And this is a bit more complicated if you have 2.5D environments. For example, if you have houses, then you have to consider the visibility also here. And so you have to rearrange this line automatically. Yeah, you can imagine at this point here, if you can see that there's an occlusion by a building, And so you have to move the right-hand side UAV a bit, little bit more to the left. So you have to move this guy over here to cover the hole so that you have a full coverage. But this is all things which the algorithms are computing automatically. And at the end, you get a plan for each UAV where to fly to at which time. And so they can synchronize the flights to the environment and ensure that they have seen every spot. Of course, I mean, if the victims, the hikers are digging a hole in the earth and they go into the hole, then you have no chance to find them. But we are not assuming they don't do that at this point. Okay, yeah, then I'm at the end of my talk, and thank you for your attention. Yeah. And I'm happy to answer any question.
Sorusu olan var mı? Buyurun. İngilizce biliyorsanız İngilizce sorabilirsiniz direkt, yoksa tercüme edeceğim.
Tamam, tamam. Thank you very much for your presentation. I would like to ask you one question. You was talking about hazmat, hazardous materials. Does this include CBRN threats?
Yeah, from our algorithm. Also from what we assume is that we have a sensor on the robot which can detect whatever we consider as a hazmat. We are not working on the sensor area, so we are working only on the algorithms, how to organize the search and how to, you know, how to do this with a given map.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Soru yok. Okay, teşekkürler. Thank you.
Thank you.
Var mıymış? Pardon, göremedik.
My question is about the rescue robots. You said that in one part of your slides, the currently the in the teleoperation, people prefer using the robots by themselves without any autonomy. Is that correct?
Sorry, I didn't get the last sentence.
The robots are autonomous right now for the rescue robots. And for the teleoperation, they are using they are used by the operators remotely. How far do you think we are away from the fully autonomous or at least
yeah, I
most
think,
autonomous rescue operations?
Also the development also with the companies like iRobot and Telemax is that they add stepwise functionality, also which is they make it a little bit smarter, so they don't want a full autonomous robot. One problem is also that to add a computer to the robot costs a lot of money, actually, also for these companies, because the mechanical part is already very expensive. And so this is a that's why it's so a slow process, also because it, and also the sensor costs more money. The laser scanner you have seen costs around 1,000 euros, and this is already a lot add-on for the platform. So this is a bit, you know, making it slower, the development, as it could be. But I think the advantage is high if you don't need so much training time for the operators. And this is the goal, so by having assistive technology, which is just assisting the people to more easy control the robots.
Evet, başka sorusu olan var mı? Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.
Sayın konuklarımız, kahve molasının ardından saat 10.30'da Doktor Mühendis Albay Ali Ulubay'ın konuşması yapılacaktır. Daha sonra kamu kurumları panelimiz yapılacaktır.